Mostly nice things. His family has a family jar into which everybody that earns money dumps the money. And if they need a new TV, a new car, they just help themselves. And it's just kind of a family affair. To tell the truth, I don't have anything bad to say about Mike to roast him in any way. To be honest with you, I felt like if somebody could win this great event with his stroke and his age, anybody could win. Receptive style of play, had that long stroke and a 9-millimeter shaft, if you can imagine that. How can you run out with a 9-millimeter shaft? I had the misfortune one time to be getting gas, and I peep out to my back of my window. This is a funny story. I'm in the middle of Pennsylvania. Who do you think I get a gander at? Gringo and Miami. Now, any of you legitimate pool hustlers, if you can think a sucker had a chance to get the best of those two, forget about it. Now, he comes from Philadelphia, a place where Jimmy Fusco wouldn't play one night because his eyebrows hurt. They put up 300 one night against a guy's one shoe and sent him out into the bitter Pennsylvania cold with one shoe. And Parika came up there, and I don't have anything against Parika, but he made a bad game with shoes, or with flakes, rather. And so James, do you know Jamesy up there? Jamesy told Parika, he said, next time you come, bring a dress and we'll take a picture of you. On the wall. That's the way they talk to you there. You know, they call you a sucker. If you win, you're barely tolerated. If you lose, you gotta go.
No, they call you sucker Rudy.
Spanish Mike, Mike O'Brien. You're the man, Mike. You're the man. Mike, would you like to speak a little English? You want to say a few words? Yeah, Mike, here. Hey, wait, Coy, get this. You're young. Young. Coy. Come in, let me believe this is 20,000. Okay, Mr. Siegel.
I know he won't believe this, but I'll tell you what, I can't remember who the first guy was, but you know, a lot of times in a tournament, you can sometimes either win a tournament or maybe you happen to get lucky when some easy matches, maybe you had one tough match, get lucky and win the tournament. That sometimes happens in pool, open draw, or whatever. But I do remember this, I can't remember what year it was. What was the year you won? 88. I remember I'm on the winner's side. There was a bunch of guys on there, and I'm watching. I never knew Mike O'Brien from anywhere. I didn't know who he was, nothing. I'm watching him come along the board, and all of a sudden, I can't remember who the first guy was, but I do know that he beat first Buddy Hall. And I'm on the same bracket. I'm sweating this. I'm looking. Look how sweet this is. 80, that was the first one you won, right? Shh, shh, you're spoiling me. He beat, who was it? Right, but the order was, I believe the order was, he beats Buddy Hall first. Now this is an 85, Buddy's in like dead stroke. Then Earl, and then I'm thinking, I'm looking at this like, oh, instead of, you know, me and Earl, me and Buddy, it's me and LeBron. I'm thinking, this is pretty sweet. Next thing I know, I go down the tubes. That was a true story. So I mean, you know, I gotta give the guy credit. He won as a true champion.
Thanks, Roland. It's starting to take some time on some of these. I've looked forward to this for a long time. The next gentleman, one of our greatest champions, Nick Varner, you know, he's led an exemplary life. It's hard to find anything bad to say about it, but there's two things about him that have always bothered me. First of all, he's the only white man with an afro out here to play for. And the second thing, what's up with that fucking gum? I would have beat him a couple of more times. What do you have to say, Barry?
I'm saying, let's move on with the program. Next is that Nick Varner. You are next on the agenda, Mr. Varner. And we have someone very special that would like to roast you. Jerry Forsythe will come up here in just a moment because he can't wait for this. But, you know, the U.S. Open, 27 years. We have 15 champions. And it's amazing, but true. The only man to win the U.S. Open back-to-back, 1989 and 90. Mr. Nick Varner, stand up, Nick. Well, you have your work cut out for you, pal. That's all I can say. You got your work cut out for you.
Yeah, and I want to tell you a little about that match where that nine ball and that cue ball froze up when it was hell. When Mike was leading 9-2 and I'm corner hooked, and my wife is like sitting right behind, and we're sitting against the rail kind of, my wife sitting kind of right behind the chairs, and Mike turns around and says, "You know what's going to happen here, don't you?" He says, "He's going to kick this ball in, and then he's going to go ahead and win the match."
That's one of the greatest matches of all time. Jerry Forsythe, come on up here. Jerry Forsythe, Cold Baby Magazine is here. We all know this is Jerry, as well as Mike Menendez is in the building. Thank you, Mike. And all the other of Conrad Bourbon, of course. Thank you, and everyone else. Professor Q-Ball. Here you go, Jerry.
Thanks, Barry. I did want to say a few words about Mr. Bourbon, the man who gives new meaning to the term high price spread. Through the year. Hello. Okay. Before he could put the tournament on this year, he went through a period of soul searching, but he never found one. Barry's a great guy. His idea of fidelity is having, is not having more than one woman in bed at a time. He's in the forefront of our sport, of course. A sport that has faced major issues over and over and over again. One of these is that concerns us all here, is what Barry's going to use for a face when that monkey wants his ass back. Okay, I'll leave him alone. Well, starting on Nick now. And Nick and I are old friends. I mean, we've known each other for a lot of years. And I've always wanted to play like Nick, so sometimes I try to see things from his viewpoint. I just can't get my head that far up his ass. He's a really great guy, though. He still loves nature in spite of what it did to him. It's not that Nick is short or anything, but when he's standing in a group, he's the last one to know it's raining. As successful as he's been, he's also had his share of bad luck. I remember one time he was playing in an event at Phil Wyndham's room in Chattanooga. Nick slipped there and fell into a vat of cigars. Came up with a turd in his mouth. Don't kid yourself about Nick. He's nobody's fool. But maybe somebody here will stop him tonight. Some people say Nick is tied with a buck. All I know, the only way to get a drink out of the man is to stick two fingers down his throat. Of course, I can't swear to this, but I understand that Nick heats the knives in his house so that his family won't use too much butter. And I was there the day that he told his kids Santa Claus was too old to get around anymore. But I want to keep him for a friend, so who else has something they want to say about Nick? Come on up, Mark.
Hey, folks, now that's a real roast, Tom. You're bad. Marty? Bad man. Marty's has had a brain fart. Oh, he's got it now. Marty, I told you not to get a howl before this dinner.
It's not even anything funny. It was after Nick got his nuts spanked by Mike in the finals there, and I was in the Navy, and I remember I was gambling or something, and still in the tournament room, and everybody had long since left, and the interview was over, and this is 2 or 3 hours after, and Nick just sat in the same chair that he took his defeat from, and I remember you just stayed there talking with people, signing autographs for like 3 hours after the whole room was empty, and Nick just stayed in that chair, and I remember telling my friend Rusty, I says, he's going to win it next year, and he won it the next 2 years in a row.
Our next U.S. Open champion, I think he's playing over there right now, isn't he? Buddy Hall is, oh yeah, Buddy, don't sit down. Buddy Hall is playing right now, otherwise he'd be here because I told him I'd feed him. And his wife too, oh yeah, yeah, yeah. I must be getting loose, I'm just kidding. I don't think so. If she is, she'd be throwing a knife at me right now, but here, anyway. Buddy Hall.
Oh boy, I'm glad Buddy's not here. I'm going to do this since he's not here. Somehow me and Buddy got on the topic one time of cue making. And I says, I can't do this. And I says, yeah, I heard Buck Seagull's making cues now. I said, I heard Buck Seagull's making cues now. And Buddy looks at me and says, I don't play with Buck. I don't play. He said, I don't play for the fuck. And then I said to him, I said, you're Bobby Hunter's making cues. Because now Bobby's making some good cues. I mean, he's making some good cues. I've always, yeah, I'm just trying, I never did a Buddy Hunter pitch. It's okay. Yeah, thanks. But I love watching Buddy play. He's another one of my favorite players to watch. But I heard a story one time. Grady was just telling me, entertaining me with it today, actually. They were going there, and Buddy was playing somebody, and they had like $800. Grady, who else was it with you? And Wade Crane had some money, I'm betting on Buddy. And then a woman who'd been around, I guess the boardroom, came to tell Grady and Wade Crane that, you know, Buddy's been up for 2 days. He's been up drinking and, well, you know, whatever, gambling for 2 days straight. And Wade Crane says, are you absolutely sure about that? She says, yeah. They took all the money that they had and put it on him, and he never missed a ball, I guess. But I don't have too many Buddy stories. I asked around, and I mean, you couldn't find anything really derogatory to say about the guy, I hate to say it, but good. Yeah, why don't you go?
Now, bear in mind when I tell you this story, folks, that we were both single at the time. There was a tournament in Augusta, Georgia, downtown next to a strip joint one year. And I happened to be behind Buddy just as the strip joint was opening. There was a door, a pool room into the strip joint, and there's eight pretty good-looking strippers in there. So they're just getting ready for their daily duties. And I happened to be walking behind Buddy as he enters that strip club. And he says, well, which one of you lucky girls are going to give me some pussy tonight? Before they can answer, I say, well, whichever one of them is will hate herself tomorrow. Now, in the old days, it's a quick story. We had a lot of fun with this. One time, Wade Crane and I were sitting in a booth, high top back. We seated down about three booths, and they had a beautiful waitress there. So we gave her a $20 bill, and I wrote a note, and I said, deliver this to that nice gentleman and smile, and you give it to her, if you please. And so she said, sure. She's delighted to make a $20 gift. She takes it over to Buddy and says, this is for you, sir, and she smiled. Now, Buddy opens it up, and it's got a big heart written there, and it says, hi, my name is Chrissy. I get off at midnight, and I sure would like your head between my creamy thighs. So now, we hear Buddy, like, laughing and giggling and everything. Finally, we can't stand it. We look over at him, and we're laughing. Of course, he knows what we did, you know. So we play practical jokes on each other like you wouldn't believe in those days. So. I don't want anybody to take offense. He said that we could be a little X-rated, and that's part and parcel of me. If I have to be nice, I'll be nice, but if you tell me I can talk bad, that's what I'm going to do.
Well, we only have 2 minutes left, so you can't talk. By the way, the 7 o'clock match will start a little bit late. Just want to let the players know, and my director, of course, about 15 minutes late, so we're not going to rush out of here. We'll be out of here about 10 minutes late. Oh, yeah, yeah, he's next. This guy, yeah, oh yeah, this, yeah, yeah, he's next. In 1992, in July, I went to Vegas to the trade show. And true story, so help me, and I think a lot of people know this. And at the time, you really had, in order to play in the Open, you had to be a known player, and it was a tour at the time. And hopefully one day there'll be a real tour, and I'm not knocking anybody, but we need the right tour, okay? In charge of our balls, okay? And we need businessmen to take care of business. And hopefully, with this pay-per-view, that'll happen. Okay, but anyway, I've been in Vegas in July, and this little guy, he's a midget. I mean, anybody shorter than me is really small. He runs up to me, and I've never met him in my life, and he goes, Barry Berman, can I play in the U.S. Open? I went, who are you? He goes, I'm Tommy Kennedy, I live in Florida, and please, praise the Lord, please let me play, Lord, please. I went, Jesus, and he said, don't say that. So anyway, so I went up to Alan Hopkins. Seriously, Alan was standing around the corner. I said, Alan, what's with this guy? He goes, oh, yeah, he can play. He lives in Florida. But he never leaves the state because, I mean, you know, he should stay there. I mean, he's just a little guy that, you know, should just stay there. But anyway, he decided to come here and praise the Lord. The guy comes here in 1992. He wins his first match against a guy by the name of Coker. C-O-K-E-R, 13-12. It was an omen, it was an act of God, and if you didn't believe in the Lord, whether you're, whatever religion you are, you got very spiritual that day, so help me, there's got to be a God above, no offense, I mean, you played great, but he gets to the finals, ESPN, never been on TV in his life, playing the number one player in the world at the time, Mr. Johnny Archer. Johnny was like waiting to win the U.S. Open, came in second, third a couple of times, and just... He now was playing Tommy Kennedy. Johnny wins the first game. Next thing you know, he didn't run nine racks, but he wins 9-1 on ESPN the whole time. Look at that face. Show him your face. He's smiling. He's smiling the whole time. Every time he's more of a ham than me. Every time the camera showed his face, you know, he didn't shoot before. He'd look up at the camera and just give him that look, Tommy. Tommy Kennedy, 1992. U.S. Open champion. Stand up. Yeah, take a look. Are you standing up? I can't believe it. Come on. Yay! And it was the greatest match. I mean, the yay cards in the background and all this stuff. I want you to, I don't know. Can you talk? Do I have to wind you up? Are you a little doll?
I just want to say one thing about what Earl Strickland said about sponsors. I have a guy that gives me $25 a month as a sponsor.
Hey, Tommy Kennedy, 1992 U.S. Open champion. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the next contestant we're going to roast is Jerry. Come on up here a second, if you will. Just stand in 1 second. That was in 92. We, you know, after Reyes, as you know, is not here. He's playing in the Asian Games, so hopefully, you know, I announced the U.S. Open dates a year, and hopefully. They won't, you know, conflict. Marty, don't go anywhere. Hold that pee. I mean, come on in here. Okay. But Reyes would have, of course, been here. He's playing for his country. So, of course, when he gets back, he'll roast Reyes. But the next gentleman before Jerry gets up there is... This was an unbelievable, another religious story. And it's the truth. Reed Pierce, in 1995, comes here. You know, fairly well known, but not completely known. I mean, I've heard of him, but was it your second or third time here? Second time here. Reed Pierce, bar table player, jam up player, wins the U.S. Open in 1995, and he beat Efren Reyes. And last night, I reminded him what the score was. He tested me. And I said, I remember the score. He goes, yeah. I said, yeah, I did, 11-6. But later that night, it was right here in this room, just as Mr. Kennedy. That night, we're in the bar drinking and having a good time. He's paying for it, of course. So I said, give me your address. I'm going to mail you a big check because I think you were flying. You couldn't put in your car, whatever the case may be. So we're on Wood Lake Drive here. This address, so Wood Lake Drive. He gives me his address in Mississippi. He lives on Woodgate Drive. How close? Now, I'm not through yet. So I said, what's your address? He goes, 123. I went, oh my God, what room were you staying in here that year? He was staying in room 123 here in this hotel. Now, if you don't believe in the Lord, you know, and I'm not the most religious person. first of all, I paid my dues to the synagogue, so I go Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and I do pray a little, actually I should pray a lot more than I do, with my background, but, Reed Pierce, some things are just meant to be, and the Lord has control of that, as we all know, and Reed Pierce, a 1995 U.S. Open champion, stand up, Reed.
I don't really know what to say. It just, it was a great, great thing. And I had a lot of guys, Johnny and Nick and Buddy Hall, we were all kind of from the South, and I just kind of looked up at them. And Johnny was a really big part of me coming out here to play and on tour and all. And, not that he won the U.S. Open for me, but I give him and Nick and Buddy a lot of credit. I watched them play and learned a lot by watching them play. Even though I'm older than Johnny, well, I don't know. but it was a great deal. I mean, it was a great win. But all I got to say, Barry.
What about playing in all them joints with the greasy chickens and the redneck? You know that, don't you, Reed? He was bulldog like Billy. You remember you came up to me when he won that year, and you said, "Look how hard Reed tried." If ever a tournament happens to be won by sheer willpower and desire, that's going to be Reed. And son of a bitch, you didn't win it that year. I mean, it was a wonderful win, too. You literally willed yourself into winning that.
Not only did he will himself, I remember during that match, Reyes used to smoke at the time. Reyes went to take a smoke break, and we were taping for ESPN. And he's pissed off. He goes, "Come on, effort this play. Come on." Oh, he went to his room. Well, I guess he was smoking something else. But anyway, he got mad. Yeah, he's up there. That's what I'm saying. But he shouldn't have left. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the next person I want to... And sometimes a roast is not all bad stuff. Like, it don't have to be, man. I mean, but that's okay. Before we get into the Scorpion and Ryan... U.S. Open champion, probably played the greatest final match in the history of the U.S. Open in 91. Hill, he and Dennis Hatch, great match. Dennis cuts the four ball and backwards, goes to the hill, 8-8. Dennis breaks the balls, nothing goes, of course it's a road map, but hey, when you're playing for the championship, nothing's easy. And of course, Buddy ran out, shot the foul ball in, opposite handed. I know my U.S. Open tapes. So let's get him while he's fresh. Okay, Brady? Well, Marty, get ready.
Yeah, Marty can, after that very apt representation, if you got to do that again for everybody. But this guy, we go back so many years, I don't know where to begin. I met him in New Orleans, where he beat me in a close match gambling. We had a lot of fun with that. It went right down to the wire. He reminded me of that the other day. And I played him once in Shreveport. And we played every day for a week, and we talk about this sometimes. I don't think either one of us pitched three makeable balls, so they put up this fucking sign. So every time I go there, you can read it. Don't come here and miss any ball and expect to win, because there have been those who came here, did not miss, and did not win. They were talking about me, right? But he plays so fucking perfect, you know what I mean? And he'll run 18 racks on you, seriously, 5 or 6 racks. He'll get out of line this far and act like he wants to hit the ball. And play perfect on top of that, and humble under his breath and everything. But seriously, he and I used to hustle pool in Oklahoma, in redneck and Indian joints. We used to hustle pool with a guy named Chester Burke. You didn't get to eat upon a given day until you beat somebody. And I promise you that would make you get a good game. Am I telling the truth about Chester? But the truth is, all the bullshit aside, nobody ever beat him playing for money. There have been several guys tried. They put up 10 or 15 or 20,000. He robbed every single one of them. Including Efren. Efren got out in 45 minutes. All right, you want to come up here and do your thing? Yeah, do your thing about me. You know, I want to know his opinion about the Mike Siegel feud. You know what I mean?
Anyway, I got to get back to work. I just want to say this is a very elite fraternity to win one of these tournaments. And I love all these guys. And I want you to know I got eaten with Jimmy Reed on his way out of town. I showed him a bag of bread.
I didn't say anything derogatory while you're gone, but I just said, say you something else. We can give you the news. No.
Say you're gone?
Well, now see you.
Huh?
Oh, all right, that's, hey, how you doing? No, all right. Buddy was telling me, I says, yeah, I heard Mike Siegel's making you. I just did this. I was at the pool room, and I said, I heard Mike Siegel's making cues. Buddy looks at me and goes, I don't know where the fuck. He looks at me again, he goes, I don't play where the fuck. Oh, shit. Anyway, that's all I got to say.
Thank you, Barry. Buddy Hall, please stand up. 91 athlete, U.S. Open champion. Thank you for being here. You just played a match.
Who won?
The other
guy. Really? Yes. Buddy, that's how special you are to be here. Thank you. Thank you very much. You two lead, you both went down. The next person, ladies and gentlemen, is, you know, a wonderful, wonderful young man, and we're awfully glad to have him back. You know, the kid came here in 96 when we moved to the pavilion, and just, you know, the week before, he just won in Puerto Rico. He comes here steamrolling and just, and he beats, of course, at that time again. Mr. Reyes, who was played, I believe, in four finals in a row. And he just rocketed himself through. And ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome back, and I hope forever, the Rocket, 1996 U.S. Open champion, Rocket. I know your jacket doesn't fit. Rodney's been working out.
I just wanted to say I appreciate everybody supporting me, and I just want to give my hats off to all these great players, because over the years, these are the guys I watched, everybody I learned something from, you, everybody that I watched. And I just want to say Earl Strickland and Efren Reyes are the two guys that I really wanted to model my game after. Some people gave me a compliment that they said I got the power of Earl Strickland and the finesse of Efren Reyes. But to me, that's the best compliment I could ever ask for. I just want to thank everybody.
Very well. Hi, Brady. Who's yours?
Well, I tried to come up with something of a roasting fashion to say about Rodney. I couldn't even think of anything. He's such a good guy. So I'd like to say something about his genealogy. He comes from a great background. He is Hawaiian Brian's protege. And some of you that go back like I do, Hawaiian Brian played as good a nine ball as anybody that ever played the game. And he'd go places and beat guys gambling that never knew what hit him. And Brian helped him, and my friend Tony Catucci and Tom River, he took care of not only Rodney, but a lot of other young guys. Tony, let me tell you a little bit about him. He has a kind of an abrasive personality, but everything that he does involves a $10,000 decision every time you play. And when the game starts, he shuts up. And he carries 10 or 15,000 in that wooden leg of his, which is interesting stuff. But he has a Zamboni collection. He bought a Bodie every year for like 40 years, didn't he, Rodney? And most of them are unused, except when he gets a young guy like Rodney. He helps him expense-wise, and he stakes him to play guys. And one of Tony's things that I thought was a great learning tool that he used, he'd get a good young player like Rodney, and they set up a deal. Like, let's say they wanted to play Archer. They go and play in Archer's pool room, like I said, for $1,500 or something. Then they come back and play in Tony's pool room. And they did that with a lot of good players. Anyway, he became, one of the best players I've ever seen for a young guy. And I was delighted to see him win. And I'm just glad to have him back among us like everybody else.
That's right. Did Corey Duell leave the building? Okay. Well, he's going to play soon. And so, as a matter of fact, Corey Duell and Earl Strickland will be teeing off in about 45 minutes. Marty wants to do, and then we have one more person. Yes. And as Efren's absence, we don't have a cue. Improvise. Well, before I roast Johnny, actually, I'm not going to roast Johnny because, you know, I have nothing bad to say about him. I think Jerry Forsythe does, but I know. Johnny Archer, God bless him, mentioned many, many times over the years when he came in second and second and third and third and fifth, how much it would mean to him to win the U.S. Open. And he really meant that. He told not only me, but so many people that he would trade in all of his titles, all of them, for one U.S. Open victory. And that certainly meant a lot to me, and I know it has meant a lot to him. And he achieved that goal in 1999. And may I introduce our 1999 champion, Johnny Archer, the new winner. If you look at the time, he just got married. So, I mean, he's playing day and night.
If he's nice, I won't tell a story about when he was a really young man and he and I took a little visit out to the Mustang Ranch.
Oh, come on, man. Hey, well, Brady, he was just giving a stroke for his wife, okay? That's all he did. He go get a stroke. Okay, Jerry Forsythe, I think he wants to stroke you.
Johnny Archer is one of the greatest nine ball players that ever lived. No one can deny that. Johnny's descended from a long line that his mother listened to one night. He's very close to his family in spite of being the only member ever born without a tail. There's some great benefits to being an archer. You get half off at the mind readers. You all know Johnny just got married, and we were all very glad to see that. Johnny, ex-Johnny, we're going to have Mr. Johnny Archer. We were awfully glad that Johnny found Mel. Last year, the man was so horny, he made the crack of dawn nervous. But this is a marriage that should work. No real family problems. Johnny's only a couple of years older than her dad. I hope you all have a chance sometime to get to know Johnny. He's one of those people that never lets ideas interrupt the easy flow of his conversation. But he's undoubtedly one of the best that's ever been, and I'm going to leave him alone, and I'll let somebody else hit on him for a while.
I think that's enough. All I can say is this, unless Brady, would you like, Brady's going to talk for a moment, and I'm going to briefly thank you because we got pool to play, and we are going to start about 15 minutes late because we have to go early, everybody has an opportunity to warm up. But
we need about 5 minutes, but Johnny, you want to say anything? Well, the truth is that all of these past champions grace any major tournament arena, and that's just a natural fact. But Barry, you ain't getting off scot-free, pal. You know, he's the guy with the big ego and the Corvette and the fucking million-dollar house and a 19-year-old blonde on his car. And a big bankroll, you know what I mean? And I never know where he's going. I don't even think he's going to get home sometimes. He parties so much, you know? But anyway, in addition to that, he started off with a little backroom tournament, and all of us that are older here remember the great times back there. I mean, that was real atmosphere, flavor, two-year championship pool. I remember when 5 minutes earlier, the table was bone dry, and then 5 minutes later, boy, you caught a little rail going in, it would go, and it would spit right out. But that built character and it built ability, and it was just as much fun, if not more, to play back in those days. And you built a great tournament. And this guy, unlike a lot of promoters that I could mention, anytime any of us came to him with a problem, a question, an idea, anything at all, a complaint, he listened to us and handled it nicely. And like that old country song says, I remember having a better time somewhere, but I just can't really remember where it was or when it was. I mean, he's the greatest guy in the world, and I'll take a big hug, pal.
Thank you. Yeah, where's my notebook? I gave it to Pineapple. Okay, why is going to do that for? We all know that. But I thought about this 2 months ago on vacation, laying on the beach in Mexico, doing a fat one. And I said, and I just enjoyed myself with one of those Mexican cigars. And I thought about this idea or something fun that we could have. After all, I used to have a lot of fun. I can't have as much fun as I used to. But damn it, once or twice a year I can with you guys. And I love you all very much. I hope you enjoy yourselves. Thank you. Thank you. The players will sign autographs quickly.